Hello. Hello, everybody. So I am Tahseen. So we have the topic time series forecasting models. And in this webinar, I will discuss about the statistical approaches, few of the statistical approaches, and few of the machine learning approaches. Because you know, time series forecasting and time series analysis, forecasting and control is a very vast field. It is more than 70 or 80 years old. So we will go through step by step from these techniques. In the beginning, first we will see what are the time series composed of. So, and then what are the basic exponential smoothing methods we use for smoothing a time series to see the patterns. We will see how to measure the performance of a time series model. Then we will study the state of the art statistical approaches, which are the autoregressive and moving average models, which are very famous and very useful still today, and they are multivariate approach. After the vector ARMA model, then we will move towards a more recent models, which are like in after 2000 and 2010, and machine learning approaches. Then I will show you some of the approaches which are very useful. We use them in our research projects, and that's the result. What are the different shapes of time series, univariable time series that we face in the real life? For example, you see the gold prices in two currencies, US dollar and GBP, so British pound. So you see these are the signals, fluctuating signals. You know, we are in the time of pandemic, and you see the oil prices are fluctuating a lot. This is an old graph, this is not a new one, but you know that in the last month that the oil prices were zero as well at some certain for 1 or 2 days. So that means time series fluctuation is sometimes very difficult to model or to foresee using these statistical or machine learning models. The newer graph I should have included are about the corona virus spread. For example, we have wave one, then we have a relaxing period for a few days, and then we are in wave two. So that means we have a time series about the number of cases, number of deaths every day, which is also a time series. And the weather forecast, for example, you see it is very cloudy outside. So this is, don't go on my background, which is sunny. So it is again a time series where we have weather forecasting based on the current temperatures and humidity, blah, blah. So these are some of the applications where we see the time series application areas. Next. A time series in a standard sense, in a very basic definition, time series is composed of four different things. Number one is the overall trend. The trend value is also called the mean value of the overall series. For example, if I am showing you a series, that means I can say the mean value passing through the middle of this series will be have a declining shape, declining line, straight line. So that will be the trend component of the time series. Then we have the seasonality component. Seasonality stands for when we have some variations or variability in the time series, which is reoccurring within 12 month time. For example, winter season, for example, some other activity, some number of admissions in a hospital in the peak summer. Similarly, we have the third component, which is cyclical component. The cyclical component repeat itself after every more than 12 months, like more than 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. So this is called cyclical. Cyclical and seasonal are quite similar, but you can say seasonal is a short variations, cyclic variation, and cyclical component is a long-term cycles, periodic motion. After these three components, whatever is left over is called irregular series or random components, or residuals, or errors, or jitters, or fluctuations. So there are different names in economics, computer science, statistics. So different fields have different names. We will simply call them errors, or we call them residuals, simpler. So basically, time series is a part of mathematics, basically from mathematics, which is from stochastic processes. What are the different possible shapes that we have to face in the modeling approach in statistics? The simplest one is the random walk process, where we have a straight line which is showing the mean value of the series, and all the observations are fluctuating about this series. So this is the easiest one and easy to handle random walk process. The second one is showing that we have an increasing time series. The trained value is increasing day by day, observation by observation. And this is called an increasing trend. And secondly, that you see initially in the first three or four blocks, the series have a small cycles or small variations. But when I go to boxes number 100, 110, 120, 130, you see the cycles are getting large in cycles. Cycle size is bigger. So that means we can say that in the beginning, in the first three, four cells, right, we have a small variability. But in the end of the series, we have very large variation. Variation stands for other name is variance or volatility. In time series, the variance, we also call it volatility. So we see in the series, we have small variations in the beginning, but large variation in the end of the series. That means the variance of the series is also not constant, and it is changing from beginning to the process when the process going forward. So that means this is an example of a series which we have an increasing pattern and also increasing variance of the series. The third example is a cyclical seasonal variation, because I see it is January 2000 to May 2003. We have three cycles, so it is repeating within 1 year. So this is seasonal variation, cyclic, and they are moving like, but you see they are not very identical to each other. So that means if I say the sales of a mobile phone in 1 year is not equal or not same as the sales of that particular brand in the next year. So this seasonality year by year, if they are selling, so they are not equal to each other. So this is the seasonality component. This is the very good example where we have a high fluctuation in the beginning for zero to first point and first to second point. But after the second point, the third and fourth point are very small. So this is called a volatile time series. So volatile time series are very much studied in the finance and economics. This is volatile time series. This is called financial time series forecasting modeling. So this is a bit different from what we study in statistics. They are related, mathematics, statistics, economics. They are linked with each other in terms of time series modeling. But this one is specifically studied in economics, because I studied in economics. So these are other examples where we have, you see, and the second one, we have a green pattern followed by a red pattern. Then in place of green pattern, we have a red pattern, then a green pattern. So in statistics, we call them motive, or we call them switches. So there are green switch, red switch, then again red switch, and then green switch. So this is a type of model which is called Markov switching model, which are difficult or higher than the normal statistical techniques, where we have high variability and we want to study the time series based on different switches in the time series. And this is again the same seasonality one. So these are some of the examples which we see in real life, practical life problems. Now, starting with the smoothing of a time series. For example, this is showing the airport dry bulb temperature. This is a data set, which is time series. And we see there is high peaks and downs, curvatures in the time series. But as a simpler user, I just want to see the overall pattern of the series. What I can do, I can remove or get rid of these ups and downs, the sharp ups and downs, and just study the overall pattern, and small fluctuations. So there are methods which are called exponential smoothing methods. And the first of them is the moving average method, which considers the moving average method, which says, for example, corresponding to every observation, take the mean of the nearest neighbors. For example, if I am at observation number five, I will take the mean of the observation, suppose 3, 4 and 6, 7. So neighbor to 5 is 3, 4, 6, 7. I take the average of them, those four observations. And then for observation number 6, I will be taking mean of 4, 5, 7, 8. So when we take the mean of the corresponding neighbors, this method is termed as the moving average method. This is one of the simplest method in time series smoothing, and it is useful to see the patterns or the variations, simpler variations that you see in the time series. If we are dealing with a quarterly data time series, quarterly means quarterly sales or something which is quarter based, then we use the moving average of 4 points, previous 2 points and next 2 points. If we are dealing with a monthly data, for example, monthly number of admissions in a particular department, then we use the moving average for 12, with length of 12. 12 means 6 points before that particular value and 6 points after that particular value. Take the average of those 12 to get the moving average of that particular point. So there is a very good repo. Somebody have developed this. So this is showing how to calculate the rolling mean, moving average or rolling average. They are same thing. Suppose we have the data about the Apple stock exchange prices, and this is the plot for the daily close price from Apple. But you see there is a small fluctuations and large fluctuations as well. By taking the 5 day, because you know week have 5 days, Monday to Friday, so based on those 5 days, this model has fit a curvature on the actual series based using the Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. For example, for Monday, it will be considering the previous 2 days and maybe next three, previous 2 days, Thursday, Friday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. So 5 days. So this is the simplest one approach, which is showing overall pattern. The green line is showing the overall pattern of the series. This is not the only package. There are more packages because R have more than 12,000 packages by the end of 2018. And I suppose maybe there are around 12,500 packages now. So there are more packages. Some of them, the one of them is Move Average, which takes the X as the input series. N is the number of points that you want to consider for the moving average. And there are so many types. For example, simple moving average. For example, exponential moving average. I don't know all of them. I use S1 and E1 only. So you can try and run these commands. And I mean, there are so many things here you can try. Okay. Next class of methods is the exponential smoothing methods. Exponential smoothing methods, for example, this is the simplest or simple exponential smoothing, that the forecasted value at time t plus 1 depends on the actual current value. A current value is represented by yt multiplied by a parameter alpha, which is the weight parameter, and current forecast value. So we are using the current two values, forecasted values and the actual values, to predict for the next forecasting value, ft plus 1. You see that ft plus 1 is composed of the actual current value, actual value and the forecasted current value. If I expand this one, this term again, so we can expand this and we can have a complete model which depends on actual values only. For example, ft plus 1 equals to weight parameter alpha times yt, and alpha into 1 minus alpha yt minus 1, and so on. So this is a long chain depending on a large number of previous actual observations. We don't try to use this complex model. We try to use only 1, 2 or maximum 3 points to predict for the next forecast value. So this is a very easy method. This is also available in Excel data analysis pack. It is available in all the statistical packages and MATLAB, Python, R, SAS, everywhere. If I use alpha equals, suppose, 0.2 or less than 0.2, that means this value will be 0.2 times yt. This means I am giving a lesser weight to the current observation, 1 minus 0.2 is 0.8, and that means 0.8 times FT means I am giving more weightage for the forecast value. So if I suppose alpha is equal to 0.2, this means I will have a smoother time series. Like here you see red line where alpha is equal to 0.1 and very smooth line. But it is showing you that the curve is going up and then going down, very smooth. But if you want a more detailed analysis about the series, for example, if we suppose alpha equals to 0.9, the pink color line, you see it is going up, then it's sharp curve, then down, then sharp curve, then down. If you want a more detailed analysis about your model, more curve about the curvatures in the time series, then we have to assume a large value of alpha. So this is the way, but luckily in R and Excel we have automatic fitting approach where the software automatically decides what appropriate value of alpha have to use so that we can have a best fit or very nice fit on the curve. We have to save ourselves from overfitting. That means we don't want to be 100% same like the blue, same like the actual series. Actual series is shown by the black color with the green points. And so therefore we have to compromise between underfitting. I mean, the red line is an underfitting model, and when it is pink line, it is overfitting. So we have to balance between the underfitting and overfitting of a time series model. Luckily, we have R package, which is so this is a R markdown file, which is showing that we consider library FPP. Data set considered is annual oil production in Saudi Arabia starting from 1996. So we have a simple command SES, no mathematical equations, just put SES, what is your time series, how many points you want to predict in future. For example, we want to see 5 years, and this is the plotting. But if so, you see we are not choosing alpha value. The time series SES package, the FPP package can have in the command SES is automatically choosing what should be the appropriate value for this. Similarly, in the sim, if we want to choose by ourselves, for example, alpha is 0.2, alpha is equal to 0.6, then we will have 0.2, corresponding to 0.2, we have a blue curve and red curve and green curve. So you see, bigger the value, it is more closer to the actual values. So this is a representation for when we have different alpha values in our time series. So this is the easiest one, which is considering current value, current actual value and current forecasted value. The second method is before this, how we assess the performance of a fitted model is based on the mean square error or root mean square error, where error represents the difference between the actual value and the forecasted value. So if we have the difference between actual and forecast values, we take the square of each difference and sum of them. So this is the mean value. Mean square error is the sum of squared error residuals, and by taking the average of it. Root mean square is the RMSE is just the average of MSE. And there are two other measures. There are not four measures. There are like countless measures. Some of them are very nice and very advanced, and some of them are simpler one like the RMSE. So we will be focusing on MSE and RMSE. You see in the previous example, we have alpha is equal to 0.1 and the corresponding measure of performance is 0.4, which is very large. Alpha is equal to 0.2, we have 0.25, and alpha is equal to 0.9, we have 0.31. So that means if I assume alpha is equal to 0.1, it is very large MSE. So we want to minimize the MSE or RMSE criteria. Minimize means as close as possible to the zero value. You see 0.5, when alpha is equal to 0.5, it is close 0.25, which is smaller than 0.31. So we say when we have alpha is equal to 0.5, it is a best fit comparative to the first and third one. So this is a way to fit a model based on the MSE criteria. The second method we have is the Holtz two parameter exponential smoothing. In this model, we have two parameters. We consider two things. One is the pattern, I mean the trend of the series, and also we want to smooth the series. So in this situation, we have two parameters, level or the trend of the line is represented by LT. BT is the slope of the line, and based on these two, I'm not going too much in the equations. We can say for the M steps ahead forecast, for example, today is Wednesday. I want to forecast for Sunday. So T plus one is four. So F T plus four. So we can forecast based on the what is the overall level. Level stands for the mean value of the time series at time T, and local trend is represented by BT, and times M is the length, how many days we want to, how many steps forward we want to forecast. So luckily in R, we have a command HT, halt, I just have to see. So we can fit the model automatically without going into details and how to select alpha and beta values. So if I go back to the if I show you in the notebook. Yes. So they are very straightforward. This is halt command, and air is a data set which is showing the number of tourists, international tourist visits, how many nights they stay in Australia. And this is considering the trend, the level of the series and the trend of the series to smooth the graph. The third one, we have a time limitation. So the third one is called a Halt-Winters three parameter method, which considers three things. One is the smoothing of the series. Second, we want to consider the overall level of the series, how the average, the grand average of the series. Number three, we want to see the local mean, for example, considering only few observations, take the average of the neighbors. So this is the third method, which is Halt-Winters or simply Winters three parameter model, and containing three parameters and one final equation. So going without going into detail, FT plus M equals to level of the series. M is the how many points ahead we want to forecast. BT is the trend, and S represent the seasonality factor. So in the Halt-Winters three parameter, we have smoothing, trend, seasonality. So three conditions to satisfy. But R is very nice in the sense that we have everything with a single command, Halt-Winters command, and it is automatically deciding on the number, what parameter should be used in the equation. But this is not limited. There are maybe more than 10 packages which have so many different commands. We have just seen as simple as moving average. We have seen exponential moving average methods only. The first one and the other ones are SES and HT. The standard methods, which are heavily used in statistical modeling in health science and everywhere, are the autoregressive models. In the autoregressive, we have two things, autoregressive component and the moving average component. Autoregressive component means that every new observation depends on its own past. For example, YT plus one depending on YT and YT minus one. So if YT plus one only depends on YT, we say we have only one time gap for T plus one to T. So it is only one time point difference, which is lag equals to one. You see YT, YT minus one, YT, YT minus two. So difference between YT, YT minus one is called lag one. And a gap between difference between YT and YT minus two is called lag two. Lag stands for how many time points we are taking the difference, for example. Moving average is the small fluctuations. For example, if we have a series which has large fluctuations, which are represented by AR, and we have small fluctuations in the series, which are represented by MA. So this is an example of a model where the YT, the future value in place of YT plus one, I'm using YT, depends on the overall mean of the series, which is called trend parameter or mean value, and phi one times YT minus one, and phi one is the parameter, adjusting parameter for YT minus one, or weight parameter, and theta one times epsilon T minus one is the, this is the moving average component, and theta one is the corresponding weight parameter, and epsilon T is the residuals or errors in the time series, or leftover. we assume that epsilon t follows a normal distribution. Yeah, this is a statistical model, so you have to assume certain statistics. And you know that in a statistical model, we have the problem that if your model not satisfying statistical assumptions, then it is doubtful. You cannot say that your model is very nice. In ARMA models and autoregressive moving average models, where we take difference. Okay, here you see, if I subtract the mean value from every observation in my actual data, then I have such model, which is called ARMA. But here we say one. One stands for we are taking the difference between the consecutive observation. I have not discussed the differencing operation to save time a little bit. But time series ARMA model have a limitation that they say that your series must be stationary. If it is not stationary, these models are not very successful. One of the major reasons how these models failure in the practical life is that those people who apply them using a programming language and they do not satisfy these assumptions, then these models can ditch you and when you are in critical need. So therefore, when you are fitting these models, you have to be very careful that they satisfy the stationarity condition. Stationarity means you have a constant mean. For example, you have a static straight line, not uphill or not downhill. And secondly, that they not the variance of the series is not varying a lot. For example, you see in this example, time series 3, we have a smaller short values, low values, then we have high values, then we again have a small values. So this is showing switches. So this series is not suitable with for modeling with the ARMA model. This one is not suitable to be fit by ARMA model. This one is not feasible for ARMA. Unless you certify that the variance and the mean are constant throughout the series, you should not use the ARMA models, or be very cautious, because they can lead you to a misleading forecasting results and not suitable for businesses. How to see which type of model we have to apply? We have time condition. So we have autocorrelation function, which is correlation between, for example, we have a series YT, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then I remove the first observation and created another series, say YT minus one. These are called same variable, but two different time points. So first value of this correspond to second value of this. This is ACF autocorrelation and PACF. There are two types of plots which are useful for deciding what type of ARMA model we have to use in our data modeling. These are the steps. So, but luckily, without going into too much theoretical concepts, we have functions. I used autoARMA in my publication about the hospital business in the emergency, number of admissions in emergency department. Auto.arima automatically fits everything for you, but it is good to have a look before you make prediction based on these models. This is not the only model. This is not the only command. This is in the forecast package. The other approach is by the newer model, which I have not used, Prophet. The Prophet package is more advanced than this forecast package. For ARMA, we have to satisfy that the residuals follow these four conditions. And to check these conditions about the residuals or the errors, we have to see the histogram of the residuals. We have to see the normal probability plot. This is a type of plot which shows that the data is following normality. The data has a constant variance, blah, blah, and data have any unusual observations. In R, we have a single command, and I will send you the notebook R markdown file for that as well, which will be considering all these steps into a single file. So basically, these are the steps which are required to perform an ARMA model. Yeah, time condition. But if these conditions are not satisfied, this is not the end point. We have new class, other class of model, which is autoregressive conditional heterozygastic models. Heterozygosticity stands for the non-constant variance, or where the residuals, the residual from this first region of a series depending on the second region of the series, or vice versa. So that means we have other class of models where the residuals are not satisfying these conditions. So they are the ARCH and GARCH models. still they are very old. They are developed in 1980s, and the ARIMA models were developed in 1970s. So therefore, still there is a lot of room for there is a lot of new models which are available online for which I will learn. So this is a short screen. I am not going through this. So this is the AutoARIMA command where you put your time series. D differencing operation, for example, do you want to take the difference between your observations or you just want to use the actual series? So this is a single command considering the simple time series, seasonality based time series. Good thing is that it also have the command to adjust for the unequal variance in different sections of the time series. And it has the possibility to use multi-core processing. For example, if you have a octa-core processor, quad-core or octa-core processor, so you can use a number of cores equals to 4 or 16, whatever. So it speeds up. For example, if you have a large series with thousands of observations, you can use multi-cores and process and speed up the process of model fitting. So just in a glimpse, just a single slide, when you have more than one variables, for example, x1, x2, x3 at time t, and every variable is a linear combination of its previous observation plus the previous observation of the other two variables. So this is the example of vector autoregressive model. This is a good repo website that is showing how to fit and how to analyze because of so this is a class of model, another class of model which is using multivariate analysis. So this was about some of the standard models in statistics. This is not a limitation. So it says maybe I have discussed four models and there are more than 30 models available in the literature and in programming. Fuzzy time series is even a newer approach. This was started in 1993 and now it was in very high pace in the 2005 to 2015. Fuzzy logic is a approach where you say that nothing is certain. For example, if I see the weather outside, I feel it is very cloudy and I say it is cold, but at the same time I will not say it is very cold and I will not say it is warm. So every temperature we feel, it depends on more than one belongness. For example, we say today it is 70% chances of rain and 30% chance it is not going to rain. So rain, yes and no. So we are saying that one observation belongs to more than one categories. So this is a fuzziness. Fuzzy concept means we cannot say 100% this will rain or 100% it will not rain. UK weather is very interesting comparatively, where you cannot say it will be sunny in the evening or you cannot predict it accurately. That means in terms of weather forecast, we still need more accurate models. So this is all fuzzy logic where we see that nothing is certain or predictable, nothing is certain. And therefore we go to this branch of approach. Skipping this side, in R, I found only one package, which is the Analyze TS package, which have four different methods of fuzzy time series forecasting. The good thing is that it is performing fuzzy forecasting along with a 95% confidence interval. The bad thing is that this model, this package is only for in-sample forecast. You cannot go outside your sample. So for example, today is Wednesday. I want to predict the temperature or humidity for tomorrow. No, it is not allowed. When I published a paper, so I developed a code R script for predicting one step ahead or four step ahead forecast for the number of admissions in the emergency departments. So this is a limitation here that we do not have much available about fuzzy time series forecasting in R or Python. Python has a newer library, which is Py50s, which a few methods. I have not tried them, but I will try them and I will develop this package as well. We have published some papers about evolutionary and natural. So this is a branch of artificial intelligence where we consider the natural phenomena, nature's phenomena like genetics and particles and termites and other insects and animals, how they behave in the nature, and use those knowledge into fuzzy forecasting models. But this is a quite interesting field of research and application because they are more accurate much more accurate than statistical models. Now, finally, we move towards the machine learning approach, starting with the very basic. We have the neural networks, which are basically a mimic or simulation version of the human brain or any brain intelligent brain. So in a neural network, we suppose we have an input layer, we have some hidden layer and output layer. For example, I hear something from my ear, it goes to my brain, it process it, this is the neural motor, it process it, and whatever the portion of the brain which is linked to do this. This produces and send back to the motor, and this produces some response which is coming from this portion. Either I speak or I smell or I hear whatever, what are the output nodes from my body or body motion. So we have in the simplest neural network, we say input, hidden, output. Input to hidden, we have a connections which are represented by arrows. These arrows are the parameters or synaptic weights. If in a simple neural network, you see 3 times 4 is 12 connections. And from hidden to output, when we have 4 times 2 is 8 connections. So you see that if even if a simple neural network, we have 12 plus 8, 20 parameters, and there are some other parameters. So we will have overall 29 parameters in this model. So when you have a simple neural network with 29 parameters, so that means for neural networks, we require a large amount of data when we want to do time series forecasting. You have 50 observations, no, it is not suitable for neural networks. If you have 200, 300 observations, it makes sense that you can try neural networks. These boxes, they are not hollow, they are not blank. There are some activity, and in mathematics, mathematical form, we call it sigmoid function activity or hyperbolic function activity. So these functions depends on what type of model why we are developing a model, for example, forecasting or for classification of time series. So we have to decide what type of mathematical function we have to use inside these neurons. Luckily, we don't have to go towards too much details, and forecast package have a command nnet. And this is another command MLP, multi-layer perceptron neural networks. We input a series here and we process them to predict the next observations. It can be one observation, it can be a series of numbers. So we have automatic commands to predict for the forecast. We can decide how many hidden neurons we should have. For example, here I am showing 3 neurons. It can be maximum 10. We can say up to 50. So it will show which model is the best based on this approach, based on this fitting. This is not the only package. There are many, many other packages which are applying neural networks as a, but I will recommend MATLAB toolbox, which have a neural networks for time series. It is very straightforward. Just you have to select your data and it will do everything for yourself. So it is like a pipeline solution, so it is machine learning pipeline for time series. This is the state of the art modern methods, which is one of them is the recurrent neural networks. Recurrent neural networks, like their name shows, reoccur. So we have input layer, hidden layer. It gives the input of the hidden layer, and the hidden layer reverse back and gives the input to the input layer. So there is a cycle between input layer and the hidden layer. How they are used in the time series forecasting is a bit tricky, technical thing. If I suppose X0, X1, X2, and so on, these are my actual observations. Then for each value, it goes into a cell, rectangular cell. It produces an output Y0. And then it goes to X, the Y0 goes to the next cell, and the new observation, actual observation, which is X1, goes to this cell. So Y0 and X1 merge together to produce a new output Y1. This is an equation for producing the output, for example, YT, depending on YT minus 1. So the output from the previous cell times W plus XT is the actual value at time T times some. So W and U are some parameters. We call them hyperparameters because they are very large number of parameters when we do recurrent neural networks and high level neural networks. So the most recent, and I will say still, it is one of the modern methods in machine learning and this is called a deep learning model as well, is the LSTM approach. In the LSTM, we say we have cells. Like previously I showed you, this is cell 1, cell 2, cell 3, cell 4, 5, 6. So that means basically your RNN and LSTM are sequential processing, like time series is a sequence. So for example, if I want to go to Y5, I have to pass through Y0, Y1, Y2, Y3. Then I can reach Y5. This is not directly like in statistics, we can say put Y5, M equals to 5, and I just directly jump to that point. No. This is a bit technical concept. So we have four things to see about in the LSTM. Forget gate. So basically every cell gets output from the previous cell and process it to produce an output. So the previous cell giving an output which we call HT-1, and the processing unit which I have shown here in the figure. This is like an electric circuit. It is doing some connectivities between the XT is the actual observation, and the left arrows coming from the left, they are the output from the previous cell. They are doing some processing and producing an output which is HT. And these are the equations where W represents the weight in different equations. H from the previous cell, output from the previous cell. XT is the current input, and BF is the bias parameter. Based on this, and we found HT equals to OT, which is this equation. But luckily, we don't have to worry a lot about these equations and anything. There is a solution, pipeline solution in MATLAB automatically. Either you should go for the MATLAB for the deep learning models, LSTM, or it is useful for univariate and multivariate both. If you don't like MATLAB or you don't have access to MATLAB, the other option is Google Colabs. Google Colabs have Python scripts, Python libraries to run on a GPU. For example, probably they allocate you one GPU or two GPUs for running a big model. For example, if you have 40,000 observations in this case, so this is the chickenpox data set in MATLAB, which is showing the number of visits by patients every day, 20, 30, 27, 34, 18. And you don't have to care, just once you have a ready to use data time series, which have timestamps and observations, you don't have to take about, not to worry about anything, because it is automatically splitting into training data set, test data set. And here it is the thing, number of hidden units, how many LSTM cells you want to introduce to your model. You can change this. We are dealing with one feature, that means we have a univariate time series. These are other characteristics. If you want to vary them, do it, otherwise don't disturb them. Even with 40,000 observations, it is showing it took 10 minutes 23 seconds. When I was working for about the Bitcoin prediction model last year, so it was taking around similar times. So if you have large data set, expect a larger time for the processing. It's a very, I have a good machine, I have GPU, but still it takes a lot of time. So you don't have to care about anything. If you want directly run this code on MATLAB, if you have your own data, you can run that code and get the results automatically, because there is a lot. One more thing, you can design your own LSTM network, neural networks inside MATLAB. In MATLAB, there is a toolbox which is called deep learning. In the deep learning toolbox, you have a designer pack. You can design your own neural networks, LSTM neural network based on this. So MATLAB also provide recurrent neural networks, LSTM, simple neural networks, neural network classification. In R and Python, you will not have very good visualization comparatively. So that's why I moved to the MATLAB side. Are some of the references, some with the simple computer and simple GPU or TPUs. And finally, we have the time series clustering. For example, at the moment, suppose we have multiple time series and we want to cluster them based on different series. So we can use a time series clustering package, which is TS clustering in R. Very nice package. I use it for classification of sheeps. We have a sheep project which was IoT based. We have sensors, motion sensors from different sheeps, and we had to classify them, which sheeps are active, which sheeps are non-active. So that is the classification into two groups. So there are some algorithms from the data mining or machine learning, which is k-mean. We tried k-mean to classify them active sheep, non-active sheep. If they are non-active, maybe they are diseased, they have some medical condition. If they are active, very good. So if they are not active, what to do? So that means this is time series clustering. Similarly, the corona conditions, we want to classify countries according to their corona cases. For example, UK and some of the European countries are high in the number of cases, while some countries have medium conditions, medium cases, and some of them are very low in number of cases of the corona patients. We want to classify the countries, the time series of the number of cases, into three clusters: high cases, medium cases, low cases. So this is a time series clustering. This package is very big, more than 50 pages, I think, in the help. And there are so many different ways to do either statistical or machine learning approaches. So yeah, this is again by itself is a field. These are the models and methods which are available. Some of them are available in R. Most of them available in MATLAB and Python. So we have used wavelets and evolutionary methods and Gaussian process, deep learning. So these are the newer models. They are not the old classical models. They have replaced the statistical approaches. When you have complex data, complex series or multivariate series, then it is better to go for these approaches and try them. Yeah. Okay. So yeah, this is me. I did BSc and MSc statistics in 2001 and then PhD in 2007. And I'm associated with the Digital Research Service, which is part of Nottingham University. Thank you very much for your time. Over to.
Thank you, Tazeen. Does anyone have any questions? Oh, we have one question. Really informative seminar. First part, a lot more approachable as our beginner. Think it would be helpful if alongside an explanation of functions to go through the code too and run through some examples. So does anyone else have any questions? Okay, if not, thank you Tazeen for that. For those of you who had to nip out or basically couldn't attend, we will be uploading the video to our website in the next few days. We've also popped in the announcements our Slack channel. You can keep up to date with the NHSR community and see what's going on and join the Slack channel if you wish to do so. We've also added our SurveyMonkey link for you to do the survey. Let us know whether you've any ideas or what you might think is possible to do in NHSR. And we also, our conference is coming up on the 2nd of November. So if you haven't joined, registered to attend, please do so. There's still some tickets left. It starts on the 2nd for the workshop week, and then the following week is all presentations. We also use Mentimeter to gather some feedback on the webinar. So the link is also in the live Q&A in the announcement. So please do give us your feedback. Any feedback is great, and we'll take that forward. So keep your eyes peeled for our next webinar in November. It will be on the Slack channel, and we'll also announce it on our webinar.
One thing, I will add the details about the equations in the slides, so to answer that question.
Okay, that would be lovely. Yeah, so we'll wait for that, and then we'll upload that to our website.
Yeah,
okay, does anyone have any questions? Okay, thank you all for attending. Thank you, Tazeen, for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.